Hello and welcome to the Resilient Enterprise Virtual Boardroom on discovering new processes with process discovery. Today, we will be discussing the latest industry trends, redefining process excellence, and how to optimize business processes and gain higher efficiencies. We will be looking at the opportunities available to unlock the hidden business value trapped in your processes and how to drive intelligent automation and process excellence. I am Avnish Singh, and I will be your moderator for today's boardroom, where we will hear from three great speakers: Narayanan Pichai, IT Finance Digital Transformation Leader at Philips; Rob McCargo, Director of Artificial Intelligence at PwC; and Srikant Deo, Associate Director and Product Management Head at Edgeware. The agenda for today will cover three areas. The first will be a presentation from Rob on future of automation, followed by a presentation from Srikant on discover new possibilities with process discovery, which will be followed by a panel discussion on how are enterprises leveraging the power of process discovery. And finally, we will have a Q&A from our audience where you can post the questions in the chat. With that, I would now like to introduce and welcome Rob McCargo from PwC. Rob.
Thank you very much, Avnish, and hello to everybody. As Avnish said, I'm Rob McCargo, Director of AI at PwC, also visiting a professor at Cass Business School. Now, I am here to talk about automation, intelligent automation, process discovery, and AI. But my role also looks at this much broader suite of impacts from a business strategy perspective, regulatory implications, impact on the workforce, some of the more economic implications of emerging technologies, and also this sort of burgeoning debate around ethical impact of things like robotic process automation and AI. And I would just start by saying is that a lot of these conversations pertaining to emerging technologies often get trapped in this equal and opposite force on the one hand of something that's far more hype fueled by marketing that sometimes takes away the reality of the real impact of this technology. But I think equal and opposite forces on the other side of this agenda is often much more from a kind of a more negative and dystopian type of agenda as well. And I think from my point of view as a practitioner, along with colleagues on the call today, I think it's important for us to sort of frame this calm, central, sober course down the middle of a debate to ensure that we're talking about how this drives real value and pulls away from some of the futurology that's often on display at the moment. One of my favorite authors I always quite like to quote when we're talking about the more pioneering end of the technology agenda is the wonderful late great Douglas Adams of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy fame. And he had a terrific set of rules that he lived his life by with regards to technology. So he said, rule number one, any technology that's invented when you're born is entirely natural. Rule number two, any technology invented between then and the age of 35 is incredibly exciting, creative, and with any luck, you can base your entire career out of it. And rule number three, any technology invented after the age of 35 is a threat to civilization as we know it and could be the end of humankind until it's been around for 10 years when it works out okay after all. And I often think about that when I'm talking about these technologies, thinking about the way that this starts to take hold, but thinking about the historical impact of the way this technology has changed business, changed society in the years gone by. And with that, we're at a really interesting juncture around this journey. I think it's important for me also to sort of frame what I mean when I'm talking about automation, AI, and other emerging technologies. The way I tend to look at it is, I think, where we are as of today in the last few years at this process of real maturity around automation itself. And then I guess the bedfellow of that is what we might refer to as assisted intelligence. I think why it's really important to get this right now, and the thing that's been really encouraging for me is seeing the sorts of different disciplines joining the meeting today across all parts of C-suite, every discipline and function covered really, rather than purely a technology conversation, is because I think the way that we adopt technology today, the way that we discover information and processes to automate today, will have profound implications for our business, for better or for worse. And it's so important that all parts of the board and senior management teams and disciplines are engaged in this conversation as of today. I think as we now move into this phase, I tend to refer it to more of the augmented intelligence phase, really seeing huge utility and power beyond previous promise in the last generation. I think where we can park for the time being is what we might refer to as autonomous intelligence. It often takes it too far off the road into driverless cars, things like robotic surgeons, and in my case, a project I'm working on, robotic auditors and management consultants. There's hope for us yet. So what I think is important to do today is really set the scene. What's happening out there on the global scene? What are the big industry trends? Where the direction of travel is going, but then bring it right back to today. And I think the handoff point in 10 minutes or so to Srikant will hopefully really give us some understanding about the sort of the raw ingredients of how to get started, what's within our grasp today. So just to sort of set a few set the scene well, over the last several years, we've run a fairly major C-suite survey across the globe, looking at the relative maturity of automation, intelligent automation and AI. And I just wanted to pull a few of the key findings out. It might be helpful in terms of how you're benchmarking your own organization against what's happening out there. I think it's fair to say that in the last 2 to 3 years, whilst there's been this huge amount of noise in the press, on social media, and in conferences about AI, it's really not been cutting through. And automation itself has started scaling, but in many cases has been reaching a bit of a logjam. It's not necessarily been driving supreme in this enterprise value. It's getting stuck in the innovation lab sometimes. And I think that has possibly started to change. We've seen a real acceleration going into the back end of 2020, and it's forecasted to scale pretty quickly into 2021. So to give you some idea around that, a quarter of businesses we've spoken to across the globe have fully embraced intelligent automation at scale. And well over a half are at a really sort of advanced experimental stage in scaling this technology as well. So it's no longer confined to a small cohort of organizations. And why organizations is doing this is very interesting as well. And for me, it looks like there's three primary goals starting to cut through. First of all, absolute focus on operational efficiencies. Definitely a resounding focus upon driving productivity. It's a perennial problem for many organizations. And of course, growing revenue, I would say, are the three main drivers, the burning platform for why automation is scaling. I think it's also getting interesting now because benefits are being realized. It's no longer the case that you're starting to see some incremental benefits. We're seeing some real leap forward here. And I'd say in particular, we're seeing organizations yielding real benefits around this, around areas such as customer experience, achieving real cost savings, interesting breakthroughs across things like talent acquisition and recruitment in particular, and people starting to realize benefits within only 2 years rather than this longer term cycle. One of the interesting areas, I think, as well, a key focus for my work as well, is around the impact around the workforce and workforce planning. So 6 out of 10 organizations we surveyed were saying they're specifically focusing in on automation around workforce applications. And in particular, with a kind of a COVID-19 lens, some of the biggest focus areas have been areas like contact tracing in the workplace, supply chain resilience, and also simulation modeling. Fascinating area to try to understand how you can bring a degree of a digital twin to the workplace. And why has COVID-19 had such an effect? And now this is a really, really kind of stark reminder of the current state of play in businesses globally. So we have seen, of the companies we surveyed, almost 3/4 of them seeing a decrease in revenues due to the impact of the pandemic. Conversely, though, we've seen, and this was a CFO survey we did a few months back, we've seen 52% of CFOs saying that they are actively and quite aggressively driving automation investments off the back of the opportunities opened up by the pandemic. So there's this interesting sort of dichotomy of effect starting to take place around the back of the pandemic as well. And we've seen this. We've seen clients of ours who had certain digital innovation and investment penciled in for a number of years down the track, 2, 3, 4 years, bringing this really close front and center and achieving that in the last 6 months or so. Now, one of the things I'm sure that will come up today is a really red hot topic and another focus of mine as well, around how do you govern these technologies? When you start opening this out to all parts of the C-suite and different functions, how do you do this in a way that drives value, that gives you that ability to measure ROI, but really allows you to bring enough scrutiny into that? And I think that ability to focus in on the model of automation, is it a center of excellence approach? Is it embedded into the business unit? Or is it outsourced to an outside provider? These are all real conversations now taking place, and still quite a broad array about how different companies are handling the automation process. I think the other thing is definitely starting to rear its head. No doubt, top of board agendas across the world is impact around managing risk, fraud, and cybersecurity concerns. And clearly, automation, intelligent automation, and AI are starting to make some profound impact around your ability to sort of automate routine tasks around that as well. But I think one of the things that we're starting to see, if we're on that continuum from automation as is today, assisted intelligence, through to the much more powerful effects in business of augmented intelligence, is to start to surface this huge array of novel enterprise risks. And we see this coming up in the press on a daily basis. We know that there's been a litany of stories surfacing around developments of automation technologies that have led to deleterious impact, poor outcomes for consumers, maybe harm in workforces, leading to regulatory sanction, reputational harm. So what's been really interesting is the maturity of some of the governance and approaches to emerging technologies now starting to come through right up to board level and beyond. I think we're starting to see far more focus around things like ethics, around bias and fairness in data, around security and robustness of systems, and across the board in terms of things like the explainability, the interpretability of what these tools are doing, the ability to scrutinize and audit them, I think is a real challenge. And there are techniques coming through to try to solve this. And then really to finish, I think there's no doubt that for every breakthrough in technology, it really does boil down to a set of human factors. I think we've seen some very, very big statements out there. We've had a big study in the last couple of years talking about job automation. You know, our study, along with several others, forecasts this significant impact on task automation within literally 5, 10, 15 years. Our said up to 30% of jobs could be affected by automation in that timeframe. But we also see this huge economic productivity and consumption bonus that comes from the adoption of these technologies. So if we get this right, if we can change workforce strategy appropriately, if we can work collegiately with government, regulators, and other societal stakeholders, there's this enormous upskilling opportunity that's just starting to take hold, not at the pace we need it to, but it's making jobs more interesting. It's removing drudgery, risk, and repetition from tasks. But we have to do this at scale. We have to do it collaboratively. And I think this is top of board agenda now from the surveys we've done to understand how we've done that. And to give you an idea of scale, PwC announced last year, our global chairman announced a $3 billion US dollar investment, not just in targeted intervention to upskill, but upskill the entirety of our 300,000 strong workforce globally, with the underlying promise that we can't guarantee what sort of job you'll have in 5-10 years time, but you'll have some sort of job if you opt in to have that lifelong learning approach. So for me, I think there's super exciting opportunities now in scope. I think we're starting to solve really important intractable problems. Often they're not the most glamorous ones to get on the front page of the press. They're removing some of those burdensome types of activities in the back office. We're seeing amazing impact on driving growth, driving efficiencies, and managing risk better. But for all of this talk, it comes down to some really, really important things. You know, I would think about my team, you know, how much of the actual time they spent is at the really pioneering end of the pyramid, probably 5-10%. So before we do anything today, it's absolutely critical that we ground this in a way that allows us to unpick where the value lies. And there's been different approaches to that in terms of process mining, in terms of a number of different technologies. But I think process discovery is interesting, and I'm really interested in sort of learning more about it today and to see what the guys here have to say. So with that, I think I'll pause. We've got some questions coming up in the panel later, and I'm now going to hand over to Srikant, who's going to present his part now. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Rob. And I think it was quite an interesting and thought-provoking sort of speech that you gave. So just taking over from Rob, as Rob mentioned, obviously this pandemic has changed not just the way we work, but even the way we live. And on that note, actually, I wanted to start my session by first wishing and hoping that all of you on this on this webinar and your families are safe and sound and healthy. Okay. And this just goes on to show that how this last 1 year and the pandemic has really changed the way not just we do business, not just we work, but also the way we think fundamentally. Okay, and in that sense, when we talk about processes, when we talk about business impact, when we talk about technology, everything is now sort of getting everything that kind of get intermingled today, okay, because of this whole situation that has forced everyone to think out of the box. Okay. And every time we talk as technology vendors to our clients, now in this last 1 year or so, every client business groups, irrespective of which business they come from and what their primary sort of function is, today they want new technology-led innovative solutions to really solve the problems, because the traditional way of maybe throwing more bodies at it or maybe throwing more people at it and it is no longer seems to be a viable option. Okay, and with that, I think let me kind of get into the topic of the day, which is around process discovery, which we believe and I hope to convince all of you today is that it's one of the very while it's a very new technology, but we also believe that it's going to be a very impactful technology when it comes to driving process excellence and driving process transformation in this new normal, in this post-pandemic way of doing things and way of doing business. Okay. So with this, let me share my screen and maybe walk you through a few slides that I wanted to run through. I hope my screen is visible. Yeah. So let me first start with explaining what is process discovery. I mean, this is kind of a new term probably for some of you because this whole space did not exist just a couple of years back. Okay. We as in the Edgeverve, we were one of the pioneers to launch a product in this space as early as 2 years back, exactly 2 years back in January of 2019, we had launched the first ever process discovery product, which is the Assist Edge Discover. And since then, this term process discovery has really caught up, not just in the automation world, but we have also seen a lot of sort of a reference to it in the business, larger business and process transformational sort of projects as well. So before we get into what is process discovery, why process discovery? Okay? As you can imagine, the new normals requires deep insights around the processes that are being run in the industry and your company. And while you always needed these insights and some of these like, okay, how do I identify the process gaps and variations? How do I identify automation opportunities? How do I identify process training needs and process compliance related challenges? While these were always needed, I think the pandemic has really forced them right in front. Okay? And the fact that today's organizations cannot run their processes unless they really understand how the processes are being executed. And more importantly, how they can further refine, transform, optimize and automate those processes. Because the kind of work environment we are getting into, the remote working challenges, the challenges of having to do with much lesser staff as compared to what we used to have, the challenges of not having the right level of controls that a typical physical environment used to provide, all of these challenges, which are actual on the ground challenges, require technology solutions for us to monitor the processes, for us to identify the gaps, and most important to ensure process compliance. So what is the solution? Okay, and what we want to propose is a combination of two technologies, one which is process mining, which I'm hoping most of you are aware, which is an existing technology which has been there in the market for close to about 15 years now. And a newer technology, which is the process discovery. We believe that a combination can really drive a lot of process excellence. Okay? And process excellence can come through improving the efficiency, through automating the processes, through making the process better in compliance and to have more additional training and knowledge for the people who are executing the process. So what can this combination provide? Okay, this combination can provide key recommendations across multiple pillars of process transformation. And those are around, I talked about efficiency. So this combination can provide very interesting, very on the ground, very granular insights around standardization, optimization, and also potentially re-engineering in some cases. More importantly, it can give you exact understanding of your process and help you understand unnecessary variations and paths that people are taking, which of course can lead you to potentially eliminate those unnecessary variations or at least standardize so that the efficiency of the overall process becomes better. The second pillar is of course the automation discovery, and I will show you some of the actual output as well as actually I will walk you through a case study also. How discovery can directly give you process automation insights. Okay. The third and fourth pillar, which we actually are more excited about as a business solution, because this combination can actually help you very clear understanding of compliance gaps that may be there in your processes. And especially in these today's remote working scenarios, it's extremely important that you have the remote auditing capabilities around your processes so that you can identify the deviations and even suspicious activities. And finally, this combination can also provide insights around the user productivity and training, which can help you further optimize and make your processes more efficient, as well as keep your working staff more involved in the entire process. The entire combination of discovery and mining sits on top of a process data layer, which again can become a treasure trove of information because it is actually going down to the lowest level of your processes. So when we talk about process discovery, in addition to the process level insights that mining provides, and I will, in the interest of time, I will not get into the mining part of it, but discovery processes very unique outputs. Okay. So one of the outputs that discovery provides is an interactive step-by-step granular task map. So when you run a process, when your people actually execute a process using certain systems and applications, discovery can capture the data and create very step-by-step, simple, granular way of show you how the process or task was executed. And these maps are interactive. In Assist-Edge Discover, you can actually play around with these maps, look at specific variations, look at multiple variations at the same time, go down, drill down into a single step so that you can understand what is being doing. So it gives you a very handy tool for process analysts and business analysts to really understand what the process is doing, how it is being done, and what are the potential opportunities. In addition, process discovery also provides a lot of business dashboards that you can actually look at, and that can help you in making very important productivity-related decisions, efficiency-related decisions that you can potentially improve your processes and make it better. From an automation purely angle, process discovery provides a very direct output, which is literally the automation requirements for any process. So the output of the map and the other insights that we generate can actually deliver you a very clear and simple automation prioritization and business case insights through something called as an automation blueprint. It's a simple 2x2 matrix that shows you which process is more suitable for automation and versus which process probably needs a bit more standardization before you can automate it. And finally, you can literally convert a discovered process into an automated process through Assist-Edge's unique capability of what we call it as an auto-automation. Okay, so essentially you just, once you discover and once you decide to automate, it's a simple one-click step to automate that process. So how does it work? Okay, as I talked about, it captures the data, but the important part here is the granularity of the data that we capture. Okay, we, as I mentioned, we capture every single user system interactions. So practically, we capture every step that the user would do when he or she has to execute a process. And that way, when we get this data, and when we get this data across multiple users doing the same process, we are literally getting what we prefer to call it as the bits and bytes of your process. Once we get this data across multiple users, Assistage Discover specifically has a unique AI engine that analyzes this empirical data and to create actionable process insights. And the insights or the outputs I already talked about, which is the task maps, the dashboards, and the automation blueprint. So with this, process discovery essentially captures the key data around your processes, converts it with using some advanced and AI into something which you can take actions around. Okay, one is it tells you exactly what your process is being executed, how it is being executed. And second, it helps you generate actionable insights from that all of that data. Okay, so it's almost like opening a book on your process and getting down to the exact details of exactly how the process is being used. So why is this so important in this new scenarios and the new normal? Because the way of working has completely changed, as I talked about earlier. And to explain this, I would like to take actual example with one of our clients and how they utilized this capability of process discovery to start their process excellence journey, even in this pandemic sort of led challenging times. Okay. So just to give a background on this particular case study, this particular client is one of the leading beverage companies based out of Europe. And their challenge was that they wanted to, even in these challenging times, they were worried about process compliance primarily. But at the same time, they also wanted to take transformation or excellence related initiatives as part of their going forward journey. So to begin with, they picked up two key processes which were significantly impacted because of this new normal. So one was about the cash collections process. While they believed that the process was running as is or how it was set up prior to COVID, but they were not so sure. So they wanted to ensure that the process compliance is being met. But at the same time, they also wanted to cut operational inefficiencies. And the second process that they picked up was around the route settlement and billing process. So again, this was an interesting process because it was being done in 10 different countries in 10 different ways. Okay, so they wanted to create more visibility around this process and create a centralization so that they could further improve and automate this process. So process discovery came to aid them. We looked at close to 50 users worth of data, more than 3,500 transactions. And what we realized is that both these processes were significantly non-standardized. Okay, as you can imagine, just within these two processes, we found out 300 plus different variations, okay, or different paths in which the way the processes were executed. Almost 30 variations were identified per country. Okay, and you can imagine the kind of the complexity that existed in the setup. Okay? And many of these variations were actually news to even our some of the business SMEs of those processes. But Discovery was able to give a very detailed step-by-step understanding of those variations, why those variations were happening, why the users were going down a different path as compared to what they were told. And based on all these data that Discover generated, the maps, the insights, the different granular data that we generated, we were able to provide more than 70 plus process improvement recommendations just within these two processes. And these recommendations that we have already provided are worth close to about $1 million of saving. Of course, they are, it is yet to be sort of validated by the businesses, but we believe that it is definitely worth this, probably even more. And specifically around automations within these two processes across obviously all the country variations, we were able to give 16 automation recommendations. Okay. So just to summarize my session and to sort of conclude, what I wanted to say was while process mining was able to give a very high level process insights in the past, I think the process discovery brings very unique value, which is about the granularity of the data that gets captured and that gets reported. It adds a very unique value proposition of being able to give very direct recommendations, not just around automations, but also around general process improvements, optimization, and other things. But more importantly, in this new normal, it helps you understand your process much better and at much more granular level. So that if you want to take any steps, whether it is in terms of automation, optimization, training of your users, a lot of that can be done with much more data, empirical data in hand. Okay, and that obviously will give your organizations a much better confidence when you get into these sort of initiatives. So with that, I will take a pause here and just wanted to leave you with the thought that if you would like to try Assist-Edge Discover, it's a simple trial version that is available on open internet. So you can try out the link that is given here and start your journey on the discovering new possibilities. With this, I will hand it back to Avnish.
Thank you, Srikanth, and thank you, Rob, for great insights into what is available out there today for the organizations and the users who are starting with automation as a journey and they want to look into aspects of process discovery as well. With that, I would like to invite both Srikanth and Rob back along with Narayanan Pichai to start our panel discussion. For the users and listeners, if you have any questions, please post them on the chat window. Our moderators are looking at all those and we will take all those questions towards the end of this conversation with Rob, Srikanth, and Narayanan. So guys, welcome back again, Narayanan. So my first question is for you. As an automation leader, what kind of process insights are you looking at when you're looking for picking up processes to automate?
Hi, Avnish. Hi, all. So it all depends on the maturity of the organization where we are in with respect to the automation journey, right? So when it comes to Philips, we are in the journey for more than 3 years now. And we have kind of identified, automated the low-hanging opportunities. So what we would be looking out for is a tool which would be able to identify the opportunities from a automatability and proposing the solutions in the sense there is maybe it would be able to identify opportunities of 1, 2, 3 from a process discovery and then proposing an ideal process which would suit our needs based on various data that it can gather, right? So that is one, I would say. The second one, I'll just take an example where we had a process where we had around 15 odd processes where we looked at it from a technical perspective. And then where we were able to identify that around 7 or 8 steps within that were common, right? So I just took it out of that individual processes. And there is almost, we had one single bot which should take care of initial steps for the around 8 processes and then the remaining processes were automated. So these, the process insight or the process discovery, if it could relate the technical aspects of ERP systems, for example, a particular T code is used across 5 different teams. Why not we create one bot which will take care of all the individual needs where today they would be operating in silos because of which these opportunities doesn't come out. But once these data are part of the system, it's just a question of we applying the logic into the system, applying some algorithm which will help us get these data. And we were able to do it and it has provided significant savings for us.
Well, that's good insight into, I mean, I'm sure it is more complicated than how easily you have stated there. So, you know, we are today in a new world normal with the COVID pandemic impacting the ways of working, how you know, the processes were. And I'm sure a lot of organizations are feeling seeing a drop in compliance, maybe, or the process know-how is getting impacted. So I have a question for all the panelists here. Can something like process discovery really help the organization to regain control over the processes and get back to ensuring that, you know, there are no compliance drops or any other significant impacts? So maybe Rob, if I can start with you on that question.
It's definitely a live topic, Avnish, isn't it? I think there's deep concerns, I think, at board level around issues of productivity of workforce, of increased risk, and certainly a prolific rise in attempted phishing attacks on home workers, and compliance issues sit right at the heart of that. I think what I was quite taken by Srikant's presentation is this is a human factor that process discovery can account for, which some of the more previous aspects of mining maybe sort of kind of sidelined to a certain extent. And on top of that, the bit, again, as evidenced by, you know, the wonderful participation we've got today, is how this cross-cuts all parts of your business. And I think the key here is in the past, we've maybe automated tasks, we've kind of done it to teams or done it to the workforce. Here, it feels like it's increasingly more becoming a kind of a democratized collaborative process that allows these tools to be used by all stakeholders, not just something led by the IT group. So for me, I think it's the sort of problems with drops in compliance that can be solved quite collegiately and collaboratively, rather than leaving it as a headache for the IT practitioner. And this looks like a technology that could offer some benefit there.
Certainly, and Narayan, I mean, you must be facing that, being, you know, leading the whole automation charter for at Philips. So do you see any such deviations or drops from the current process and use of something like process discovery?
Sure. So Avnish, I'll answer in terms of the way we are operating our automation journey, right? That is, we are following a simple SDLC lifecycle. But the important thing within that, as a part of our automation journey, is we have the controls, internal controls validation as one of these important steps within the automation journey. So there is a process gets identified, gets revisited, then we have a to-be process. So we actually validate the current controls that we have, and then the to-be controls that we want to build. One of the things that we have done consciously is trying to bring in more controls into the automated system. The to-be process is getting defined in such a way that they are having the automated controls in, so that we remove a lot of manual controls. So this actually has helped us remove a lot of effort that goes in validating the manual controls over a period. So this has actually enabled us during the COVID, there was no issues for us. We were just operating as it is, right? The bot was up and running. We were just connected from nothing was getting disturbed. So from a controls perspective, since for whatever process which were automated, those were part of the inbuilt process, the impact was much lesser, right? Number one. Number two, relating to the process discovery, obviously it's going to help us identify newer opportunities, and which means if we know how to automate things, having the right controls into the process, then we would be able to have a better environment as we move along. And I would personally thank COVID in a lighter note, because the adoption of COVID, adoption of RPA, the importance of bots has actually increased, right? The adoption without we pushing for it has actually increased. Again, I was thanking on a lighter note, but on a serious note, it is actually helping us.
That's good to hear that you, and of course, I've seen your journey. You are always ahead of the curve when it comes to adopting you know, this technology, and of course using automation across your IT and business landscape. And Srikant, then maybe the same question for you. Are you hearing some of your clients come to you and talk about, you know, how they are seeing an impact due to the current situation and asking you or your organization for help for on the process discovery?
Absolutely, Anish. And I think that's one of the most important, I would say, the benefit that discovery can offer. While we can, of course, talk about the operational benefits like the automations and improvement and optimization. But I think in this new normal, what's probably the most important factor for most organizations is the process know-how and the at least the sense of the control that they really want to get back today in this new in changed environments. And we have seen many clients, I remember a recent conversation with a Japanese client who really want to understand how the processes are being executed. They're really worried. And even the case study that I talked about, while they believe the process is being done in a certain way, what discovery literally showed them is that there are a lot of variations from what they knew. And now they feel much more confident when they talk to people, when they want to do any initiatives, they feel far more in control. And I think that's the power that discovery can give.
Wow, okay. That's very good to hear. Rob, you had mentioned in your session about, a lot of automations got stuck in the lab and they don't really make it to the real world. What do you think would be the major roadblocks faced by organizations in bringing those out or even to scale up the automations?
I think there's been over the last few years some challenges around framing the ROI, and I think there's undoubtedly sometimes down to maybe a lack of digital competence at board level. Sometimes that is a challenge. And sometimes I think the more pioneering end of these technologies don't necessarily derive value in more traditional ways, like maybe IT of old. If you're looking at some of the more cutting edge types of proofs of concept, my team will be bringing out, they might in many respects fail. Most of them will fail. And I think for big, mature, heavily regulated industries, there's this inbuilt philosophy and mindset that does not accept any failure. So it's really hard to give that degree of latitude, of freedom, autonomy to the innovation teams to have a go, practice, experiment, break things and put them back together again. So it ends up, you get into like analysis paralysis where you just can't move things forward. So I think a lot of this comes down from C-suite down. How do you permission these teams to experiment, ideate, innovate, and allow them to fail and encourage them to fail? And I think for the first time in my career in the last few years, my boss is saying, if you're not failing at something, then you're not trying hard enough. So a lot of these things aren't technology related factors. It's more philosophy and C-suite mindset about this as well. So it's interesting. I mean, it seems like it's gaining more traction. I think there's also, on top of that, Avnish, there was probably a race to automate maybe sort of 4 or 5 years ago that didn't really bear fruit. People were automating the wrong processes. It wasn't giving that ROI that they expected. And then it got into this really chaotic landscape of bot chaos. You ended up having 300, 400, 500 separate bots across your back office with very little coordinating strategy. So I think this is now a kind of a time to draw a line in the sand, take a step back and look at these much more sophisticated ways of teasing out where the value lies in a process.
Well, yeah, certainly. I mean, I've seen that in some of the conversations I have had with organizations on, how they dropped the processes they started with, and then, then found new ones to begin, at least the first steps they took. Narayan, you mentioned about, these pre and the post automation controls that you have, now looking at when you're doing your automation journey. But when you were starting, did you see any major roadblocks when you were trying to scale it up in the initial phase of automation?
Sure. So again, one of the things that we did it right in Philips is building the right team, right? When I say right team, I just want to qualify what we mean by right team in the context of RPA, right? RPA, according to me, it's a semi-self service kind of a tool. And me personally, I'm coming from an IT background, right? I'm an IT technology person. Today I sit within a function driving the transformation for the function. So the point is, for IT, this is going to be another tool where they would be able to implement, and then there is another set of bot automation would be typical IT projects. So the ROI also increases, right? So if we operate within the function, knowing what they really need, but making sure that we don't compromise on the IT principles, IT processes, and other things, right? So having the right technology person within the function was one key thing for us to have it in place. Second one, we have built a lot of techno-functional resources within the organization. And that what it means is there are technology individuals who had keen interest on learning the functions, and the functional individuals who were really keen on to learn the technology. So we have bonded these individuals together who is able to develop, manage, and upscale the bots, right? And this is one key thing where one, we identify the right set of process because we have functional people. And while we are identifying the right set of process, we have technology people who would be able to evaluate whether what we are identifying is the right one for automation, right? We had applied lean principles where we had eliminated many of the opportunities, simplified, standardized, and then we have automated. So applying lean was another thing where we were not automating everything. So we were not automating waste, right? Otherwise, whatever we should have ideally eliminated, we would have automated. So I would say the skills, the ROI was taken care of because of having the right skills getting executed by the functions with the technology individuals. And the third one is that is applying lean and making sure that we don't really automate the waste, because we get excited and then end up automating whatever we get in the hand to start with.
So does it like boil down to just picking the right process to and identifying which is the right process?
It's easier to say, but picking up is going to be the key. The crux is in doing, right? The art is in doing it, right? And we need to practice to get there.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Sorry. So with that, I mean, I do see some questions coming up from the listeners here. While I have some questions, I can pause those and take some, because they're kind of related to what Rob and Srikanth, you were just mentioning, and what you just said. So one is, do you find more historic companies or those with more mature demographics have a harder time in transforming? And Rob, maybe you can take first, Srikanth, you can go next.
I mean, it's probably easy to assume that is the case. It's probably not so straightforward. I mean, I've seen some traditional, leading organizations actually who have done some amazing things. And part of that is recognizing that digital fitness at C-suite was not up to level. And I think that part of that is board education, not just because it might be of curiosity to a member of your leadership team to become tech savvy, but it's an existential threat time. This is essential curricula that they have to engage with. But I think it's about translating that in the domain they operate in. So it's not a case of everyone having to do a computer science degree or a PhD in data science. It's about the understanding of the implications, opportunities, and risk within their field, whether it's HR, procurement, compliance, etc. I think what some of the traditional firms have done quite well is invert the pyramid a bit. And there's been some terrific examples of things like reverse mentoring. That's gone really well, linking them up to some of the maybe more digital native parts of their organization. One thing we trialed as well, we did like a shadow digital board. So when there were consequential decisions being made from a technology perspective, it was run through the shadow board as well for endorsement or challenge. And they did have a right to intervene, which was quite an interesting perspective. So, no, I see some amazing innovation in traditional businesses, but it is very much about that sort of digital fitness at a board level. One thing that we've done, actually, we launched this digital fitness app that engenders a bit of competition. So you can baseline your kind of digital fitness, and then you can do micro learning to bit by bit build up people's digital literacy over a course of time and in competition with their peers. So you can engender a bit of a gamification into the process as well.
How interesting. That's certainly very interesting. The digital fitness and measuring that. And Srikant, do you also see a pattern or a difference between historic companies versus some more demographics adopting this?
Not really. I mean, I would probably echo Rob here. It's not about demography, or it's not about how old the company is. I think it boils down to the agility in the company. And the way I would probably measure that agility is the distance between a decision maker when it comes to a process or business to the people who are actually going to execute that. Okay. And when it comes to operations, that distance is usually measured in terms of the so-called subject matter experts in the process versus the people who actually execute it on the ground. Okay. And if the distance is large, you will probably end up having these challenges, both in terms of compliance, training, everything, basically. One of the best examples is how do you manage your process knowledge? Okay, some of the companies, and it has nothing to do with, again, whether they are old companies or new. If you are managing your documentation primarily based on documentation, if your entire knowledge is in that, you are most likely to get outdated very, very quickly, okay? Because the business realities are changing and people find newer ways of executing. Okay? So that distance is what I think will really sort of measure whether the companies will need these kind of technologies sooner rather than later.
Fantastic. There's another question while I have you there, Srikant. This question was is directly to you. You had mentioned about savings using during your presentation.
Yeah.
How do you calculate the savings that you had mentioned?
So it's a very valid question. I think it always comes up. And it has been coming up for process mining as well. And obviously it comes for process discovery as well. So I would probably break it down into three parts. Okay, the first two are more tactical sort of savings, but the third one is more strategic or more broader. The first one is all about the efforts. Okay, essentially, as in the case study that I talked about, we came up with some 70 odd recommendations. Would the consultant would have been able to do it manually? Potentially, yes. Okay, the consultants that we worked with, they said they would have probably come up with half of those recommendations. But even that would have taken them almost 3 months of interviewing multiple business people, going through the details of the processes and all that. So discovery cut short all of that time, all of that effort. So that's one direct saving. The second more important saving from an automation perspective is that we cut short the entire discovery requirements to automation timeline as well. Okay? Again, we cut down a significant amount of time and effort there. But the third, which in my mind is probably the most important, which is a more long-term strategic impact, is one is it as we have been talking about, it opens up your process know-how to you. Okay, it tells you how your process is. It tells you what are the gaps in your processes. Okay, and that in many cases, almost 60 odd implementations, what we have done about this Discover tool, we have realized that we have almost always given some new insights to the clients that they were not aware of, that they did not think is happening in their processes, in their environment. Okay, so that I think is the most important one. You really understand your process. You get to know about your process, something which you did not know earlier. And that can drive a lot of decisions.
I mean, few questions on that which came up, but as a summary, are you really installing something on these source systems to get this insight, or how are you monitoring this?
Yeah. So there is a data capture utility, as we call it. We call it in our product, we call it a sensor. So, but that is not installed on the individual applications. It is actually installed on the person who is executing those tasks. And this is completely application agnostic. So we can capture data not just from standard web or ERP applications, but all across thick clients, secrets, or any applications that usually are part of your process execution. But yes, there is a data capture utility.
And then there's an interesting question. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Anish, just adding on to Srikant's comment for the earlier question, right? there are a lot of intangible benefit that comes out of it, right? Where there were a lot of process insights. Srikanth did mention about it, where we have seen a lot of variations that we were able to identify in the same process, in the same team, sitting in the same location, right? Consider a scenario, a process getting executed from a multi location. The same process get executed in n different ways, right? So one, you will be able to standardize the processes and you will be able to automate them pretty easily, right? The moment you identify the variations, that gives you the opportunity to automate, right? So the variations is something that you would be able to identify pretty easily with this. Through interviewing, through manual interactions, for sure, we'll not be able to identify those.
That actually does answer one of the other questions that came up. Was
I agree that
you answered before I even asked that. Like when you are doing this process discovery and then automating the process, and you see the non-compliance to begin with. So did you also assess if there was a way to make the process simpler to reducing number of steps? To make it flexible. So, I mean, I think you kind of touched upon that, but if you want to add on that.
We don't look at it as a reducing the steps. We look at the process, which is going to suit the needs, right? Maybe the steps could be, there is maybe 5 or 6 steps more, but that might be the ideal process, which is getting standardized, right? So, which will, maybe it will cater to the 80% of the population. So it's not just about the step, it's about the discovery revealing us what is there in the system. And in some cases, that is, we have human interventions to take the right decisions. In some cases, the tool has provided us the recommendation, which we were able to just go ahead and implement it.
Okay. And how did you calculate, once you finally identified the process, did you go into identifying savings and how did you calculate the savings if you approached it in that manner? That is another question that is on the wall.
So for us, savings, we have saved around greater than 500 FTEs, right? These are real FTE savings, which has hit our books, right? Number one. So that is also one of the reason why business was pushing us to have this program extended for almost all within finance and then get it implemented, right? Because they were seeing the real savings on the ground. So how we calculate the savings is, look at the process, look at the volume, that is the number of steps involved, that is do a benchmark with respect to how the individual does it, sit next to them, identify it, or the tool gives us the time it has taken, the waiting time we add it, and that is look at the volume we process it, we get for a particular period of time, right? Multiple factors need to be applied to arrive at a number, but the moment you start doing it, maybe for a few processes, you might stumble. But that is, if you decide on the parameters to be applied, like what I was mentioning, maybe more than that also, you will be able to arrive at that is the effort that we are spending.
And Rob, do you want to add to that? I'm sure you're talking to a lot of organizations out there. How are they, or what's the best way to identify those savings?
Well, I mean, I think what Nana was saying was fascinating around the sheer scale of opportunities now and measuring it in FTE. I think, though, the more sophisticated organizations are then looking about the ongoing accretive benefits that they can then deploy those 500 people to. And that plays back into that sort of upskilling strategy. And of course, if it looks like, you're simply looking to cut cost, then clearly the workforce engagement can drop. So if there's benefits at the end of this around removal of drudgery and administrative tasks, and as a part of that contract is that commitment to upskilling, career longevity, and fulfillment, then I think you can really start seeing other ROI, which doesn't fall necessarily directly into the financial camp. You know, employee engagement, well-being, sickness absence goes up. And all those other factors that I think organizations are starting to think of much more through a sort of an ESG lens now, purely rather than pure bottom line.
Right. I mean, we are at the end of the hour, top of the hour. So just one last question. So for, Rob, do you think the organizations who are just starting their journey, should they look at process discovery first and how... Any advice for
Well, I mean, I must admit, it's been an education for me as well this hour. I've learned a lot myself, and I think clearly these tools are far more within reach. So I think absolutely there's a benefit to this. I think what's maybe tipped the scales is more about the accessibility of these tools, and the price point clearly is important in this. So if these are accessible, democratized, and available, then of course that makes sense. I think the worst thing, as Nana was saying very pertinently there, the worst thing you can do is automate bad process.
And your advice for new users or even people who are already on this journey, and how to bring in process discovery?
Sure. So I would say what would work, right? It's again, according to me, is get started with the automation journey. Apply the lean into your automation journey. So you start to eliminate, simplify, standardize, automate in the journey. So do it smaller in the automation journey. So in this, you would know how to eliminate or what to eliminate, simplify, standardize, and you would have actually automated. Then bring in the process discovery, right? Maybe just, I'm not saying that is do it later, but maybe a few months into the journey, get started with the process discovery. Then what happens, you know exactly the output that you're going to get out of process discovery. You know how to use them, right? You know what to eliminate, what to simplify, standardize, and automate. It's like crude, right? Refining a crude, if you know what you're going to get, right? Petrol, diesel, kerosene, and others. If you don't know what to do with petrol or kerosene, right, then it's of no use. So get started smaller, do those things, understand. And that is, once you do process discovery, you exactly know what to eliminate, what to standardize, what to simplify, and what to automate.
Certainly. I mean, and Chikant, any word from you? You probably talk to a lot of organizations out there. Anything you would want to give as an advice to our audience today?
No, I think I would echo Narayan. I think it's a very practitioner's view that he has given. There are many processes that you already know that can be automated. It's a very, obvious candidate. So yeah, definite recommendation would be to start with those. But we obviously have seen that many clients beyond the point would want to use tools like process discovery to identify more and more candidates. And more importantly, going back to Rob's point, automate the right processes and avoid automating the wrong processes.
Certainly. It has been very good to hear from you. With that, we are like at end of the session today. It was very good talking to you. Great insights for me as well. I hope our audience was also able to get some good points around process discovery and picking up the right processes and starting their automation journey. So thank you, Rob. Thank you, Narayanan. Thank you, Srikant, for your time. And thank you, audience, for asking very pertinent questions. We hope you enjoyed the session. And please feel free to reach us at edgeverve.com for any questions. Or if you would like us to have a one-on-one meeting with you and bring in our experts to talk about process discovery and process automation, we look forward to hearing from you. Thank you, everyone.
Cool.